Welcome, everyone. Today's topic is most effective solution in finding profitable rental markets. About 2.5 years ago, when we started in real estate, we bought a 2-flat thinking that it was going to be a great deal for buy and hold. That was our second property. But guess what? We bought it in a really bad neighborhood. We hired the worst contractor that you can possibly think of, and then we put the worst tenant. We pretty much did not collect any money whatsoever. So we ended up doing an eviction. So it was pretty sad, pretty depressing. What we thought it was going to be a great rental, we didn't know any better what we were doing. So we were determined, as time went by, to identify the top most profitable rental markets, because we didn't want to ever go back to where we were about 2.5 years ago. Because most people say, well, you know what, I want to buy and hold, build a rental empire. That's all great, but guess what? If you build your rental portfolio in a non-rental market, that's a big problem. It's like building a great humongous building without a great foundation. Guess what's going to happen? It's going to collapse. It's exactly the same thing for your rentals that have to be in a rental market. Okay, super, super important. Because let me tell you, when you are not in a rental market, what's going to happen is that you're not going to have collectible tenants. You're not going to cash flow. You're going to overpay for the property. There are many other factors that are going to affect your bottom line. And that has effects when you refinance a property, when you want to sell the property. So it's just a big, big deal. So what do people do today to find great rental markets? Have you heard of driving for dollars? To me, that is a waste of time and a waste of gas. Why? Because oftentimes you won't be able to distinguish between a great street and a bad street when it comes to pricing. You'll be surprised, but especially in the city of Chicago, there are some, and even suburbs, there are some pockets, right, that price can double from block to block. I mean, it's just amazing. So you might not be able to identify that. So what you need is all the information at your fingertips, even before you go into the area. Okay, you can still drive by the area, but just to identify certain pockets. But you shouldn't be doing that to identify great rental markets. Now the question is, we keep talking about rental markets, great rental, profitable markets. So what makes a great profitable hot rental market? What do you think that makes an incredible rental market? We need 2 factors, okay? Number one, you need affordability. And number two, you need very high rents. That makes a great, hot, profitable rental market. Just 2 things. If you have one or the other, it's not gonna work for you, for your rentals. It is that simple. Let me give you an example. For instance, Evanston has great infrastructure, great employment, low crime. There are certain pockets, rents are high, but guess what? Property prices are very high. So even though you have high rents, you don't have affordability. Therefore, if you buy a rental in Evanston, you may not cash flow. You're gonna find collectible tenants, but it may not cash flow. That is why you have to focus on affordability and high rents. Let me give you an example. The first property that we got, the 2-flat, right, that I was telling you about in a bad neighborhood. So we found affordability. Well, guess what? It was so affordable that the rents were down the toilet. I mean, they were so low. And not only that, but since the neighborhood was not that great, we could not find collectible tenants. Luckily, we ended up selling the property. We just didn't want to have that headache. because even contractors didn't want to go to the property to make repairs because they were afraid that their truck was going to get vandalized or stolen. So it was just insane. It was crazy. And it was just also unsafe for our safety. So we didn't go there often. That is why you have to find a city or neighborhood that has affordability and high rents. Now let's get into more details. What do we mean by affordability? Like 100,000, 200,000, 300,000, 400,000? What does that mean? That's too generic, affordability. And what do we mean by high rents? 1,500, 1,700, 3,000? So where is the sweet spot for you to maximize your rental profit and to minimize your risk? Here it comes. Affordability, you need to be looking for single family homes, ideally three bedrooms, two baths, no basement, under 175,000. Okay, that's what's called affordability. Again, 175,000 for a three bedroom, two bath, no basement, hopefully with garage. Okay, that's affordability. And that does not include the price of the rehab. Okay, so that is just purchase price, no more than 175,000. Okay, now great rents. What's great rent? Anything over 1600. Okay, now the top rental markets, they're going to be starting at 1800 and up. So usually for affordable rental markets that have great rents, the rents are going to start at 1800 and they usually go all the way to 2200, 2300. Okay, so you have great, very strong rents, but yet the purchase price is very affordable. In fact, last Sunday, we went for breakfast with George from Blueberry House Pancakes in Oak Brook. So he was telling us that, you know, he had a rental in Berkeley. It was a two bedroom, one bath. He was collecting $1,500 and he was kind of surprised. And I told him, well, George, there's no surprise there because guess what? Berkeley happens to be number one rental market in the suburbs, okay? What it means is that you can still find a two bedroom, one bath in Berkeley for under 120,000, but yet you're gonna be collecting 1,400, 1,500 in rents. So that's what you need. So I'm gonna repeat this because this is the secret sauce. And there are two steps to the secret sauce. Number one, you have to have affordability, less than 175,000 purchase price. And then the area ideally should be B, B plus, A minus. Okay, that's ideal. And then high rents. Rents should be over 1,600 for a three bedroom, two bath, no basement. Okay. Now, the second factor that you need to pay attention to when looking into rental markets, it's what's called the 1% rule of thumb. So what it means is if you find a property for, let's say, 150,000, okay, you have to collect in rent at least 1% of the purchase price, which is 1,500 a month in rent. If you find that, it's a great rental market, okay? So let me give you an example. We recently bought a property in Elmwood Park. Actually, in fact, I took you all live and online to that property last weekend. So we bought the property for $151,000. Once it's rehabbed and rented, the rent for that property is $2,000. So the rule of thumb, when we looked at the property, we said, first of all, does the area, Elmwood Park, support our rental exit strategy? And indeed, it did. Elmwood Park, it's a great rental and flip market. The second thing that we needed was to find out how much we were going to rent the property for. So we bought it for $150,000, used the 1% rule of thumb. We needed to collect at least $1,500 in rent for that three-bedroom, two-bath. And the rent in Elmwood Park for a three-bedroom, two-bath basement will go for $2,000, okay? So that's a perfect example of a great rental market, okay? Now, the question is, how do you find them, right? Because there are over 400 areas or neighborhoods between the city of Chicago and suburbs. So what are you going to do? Are you going to be, what kind of research are you going to be doing? Are you going to go to Rentometer? Are you going to go to Zillow to find out the difference? It would take you months to figure that out. Well, guess what? We've done all that research for you, and we compiled that into a single spreadsheet, okay, that we're going to make available to you. But before I show you the spreadsheet, I want to show you what we did first before we came up with the spreadsheet, okay? So let me give you a quick demo. In Chicago Deal Vault, we have a section called Area Reports, okay? So this is where I used to come in the past. I would say, well, I'm looking for a rare rental market. So in here, I would just type an area. So for instance, I would type in Bolingbrook. So I'm gonna show you here what I used to do before we came up with the spreadsheet that had just top rental markets. So in here, Bolingbrook, it's a B area, and then the approach. We are going to tell you when it says cash flow, that means it's a great rental market, okay? It might not be the top rental market, like top 10 rental market, but it supports cash flow, okay? So it's good to buy rentals in Bolingbrook. Is Bolingbrook a top 5 rental market? No, it's not. So let me just go over to the right in this column. It says sweet spot to buy right here. DE, that stands for detached or single family home. It's 250,000. So you might find properties that are not that affordable in Bolingbrook, but yet the median rental income for a three bedroom is 1500. So in this case, it doesn't meet the 1% rule of thumb, right? So you, if you're going to get into Bolingbrook, you have to buy something in the ballpark of around 150,000. Why? Because rents are about 1500. So remember the 1% rule of thumb. So you can work your numbers backwards. So if you know what the rents are, let's say the rents are 1600, right away, you know, you shouldn't pay more than 160,000 for a three bedroom, two bath. It is that simple. Okay. So Bolingbrook, it's a great market. It's got a population growth for over 30%. But again, what makes a great rental market is affordability and high rents. And guess what? The rest, such as, I'm going to pull this up to just to show you. So the rest of the factors that we need to consider when looking at rental markets, for instance, amenities, cost of living, crime, employment, housing, schools, and so forth. When you are looking at a great rental market, these amenities will be good or above average by default. That is why it makes it even a more appealing rental market. So let me just, since we have Bolingbrook pulled up, let me just show you the numbers from Bolingbrook that you need to pay attention to. Okay, so one of the things that makes a great area is population growth. You want to invest in an area that has positive growth, which means that people are moving into the area, and people are going to be moving into the area because there are great sources of employment. Okay, the infrastructure, schools, but primarily number one, employment, number two, schools, Number three, safety. That's what's going to make people move into an area. So you've got to become familiar. Once you identify a great rental market, please make sure that you check population growth, schools, and low crime. Okay, but we're gonna go down to the rental analysis. Okay, so I'm gonna scroll down to the rental analysis. So what you want to know here, what we're gonna tell you is the average or the median rental price and how long they stay in the market, because that is very important. Great rental markets are gonna have high rents, and guess what? They're going to stay on the market for about a month or less. So they are very hot, okay? You're gonna be able to rent them very quickly. And here we just give you the breakdown of like the two bedroom, a three bedroom. So Bolingbrook about 1500. And then we're gonna tell you roughly how long it takes for them to get rented. So what you want to stay away from is areas where rents are low, where vacancy is high. Why? Because if you buy a property in a neighborhood where the vacancy is over 10%, guess what? You may not find a collectible tenant in 2, 3, 4 months. I mean, it's insane. Let me just give you an example of it. So for instance, I'm gonna pull up Riverdale, okay? So Riverdale, okay, so let me show you an example of that. So here, Riverdale, it's in Chicago. As you can see, it's not the safest neighborhood. It doesn't have great sources of employment. That is why it's got Fs throughout. Now let's go to the rental and also population growth, right? So I'm gonna scroll down. Population growth is negative, okay? Which means people are moving away from it. Why? Not enough sources of employment, high crime. And then I'm gonna show you right here on their housing occupancy, vacancy, vacant housing units right here. It's a 20% vacancy. That is very, very high, okay? 20%. You're gonna end up with at least, right off the bat, 2 months of vacancy every single year when you have turnover, okay? So 2, 3, up to 4 months. I mean, it's just crazy. And then let's look at the rental market analysis for it. Okay, so if we scroll to the bottom right here, so the rents are very low, 900 for a two bedroom, 1100 for a three bedroom house. I mean, it's just super, super low. Of course, property prices are gonna be lower, but you may not find collectible tenants. That's the problem. So this is an example of an area that doesn't make any sense to buy rentals. This is in fact a flipping market, okay? But not a rental market. So the first thing that you need to understand is, once you decide to do rentals, you have to focus on rental markets, okay? Because there are flipping markets. Like Riverdale happens to be a flipping market. So right here, if I scroll up, we're gonna give you in the summary right here, we're gonna highlight flip for the approach. So this is a flipping market. And also you're gonna see right here in the approach flip. So Riverdale is a flipping market. So this is the perfect example. We bought a property, a rental in a flipping market. So we paid for it and big time. So I wanna make sure that you do not make the same mistake. I wanna make sure that you focus exclusively in top hot rental markets where there's affordability and rents are super high, okay? And vacancy is less than 10%. Now, so how did you find these? So let me show you. We created a spreadsheet now off of DealVault. How did we do that? You're going to come to the approach under the filtering, and then you're gonna select cash flow, okay? Well, let me reset this. And then, so I'm gonna select cash flow, and then I'm gonna pick the area type. So remember, we said because of the pandemic, you need to focus on primarily B areas, B plus, A minus. C and D have been affected the most by the pandemic. Okay, so let's say that I want the top rental market. So all you need to do is click on search. Okay. Now we have hundreds of areas. So how do we know what the top rental markets are? The way that I like to do it is I like to sort it by purchase price. So sweet spot to buy. Okay. So right here, I'm going to start from bottom up. Okay. So the cheapest to the most expensive, and something that you need to pay attention to is the right column that says median rental income. So you want affordability, but yet you want very, very high rents. So let me give an example of the first one. So Park Forest. Park Forest, you can find great deals for under 50,000. But guess what? Rents are not the highest. And not, so we're gonna just continue down the list. So you have South Holland, Richmond Park, Lyons, Round Lake, Old Ship, Berkeley. So just pay close attention to Old Ship and Berkeley. Okay, just as an example, look in this column that says sweet spot to buy a detached for Old Ship is 150,000. Okay, and look at the rent, 1800. So if you do the 1% rule of thumb, if you buy something for 150,000, but you can rent it for 1800, that makes it a great rental market. Okay. Not only that, but livability score. You see these next to cash flow, you have livability score. Anything over 70% or 70 points, it's great. Okay. Because guess what? There are going to be some areas that, let's say, you can buy something for 25,000 and you may collect $1,000 in rent. So the 1% rule of thumb is going to work great. But guess what? The livability score is less than 65, 60, which means that it's a depressed area where you don't have infrastructure, you don't have employment, crime is high, vacancy is high, you won't find any collectible tenants. So what good does it make to buy a cheap house where you cannot find tenants for? Does that make sense? So you really need to be smart, but yet it's so simple to identify those markets. Again, I'm going to repeat what you need to focus on. Affordability, less than 175,000. You need to look for areas where the rents are over 1,600. And the livability score has to be over 70, okay? That's going to make it a B or A minus area, okay? Perhaps a C area. But we just want to focus right now in this economy in B neighborhoods, okay? So right here, check out Berkeley. That's what I was telling you. Berkeley, the sweet spot to buy a detached or single family home is almost 160,000, but look at the rent, 2,100. So if you do the 1% rule of thumb, you pay 160,000. Technically, you should collect at least 1,600. Guess what? You're gonna be collecting 2,100. So can you imagine how much you're gonna cash flow in Berkeley? You're gonna be cash flowing 350 and up, okay? It is that simple. If you can find a deal for under 160,000 purchase price, okay? Not including the rehab. And look at the area type, it's a B, livability score over 70%, okay? So now let me show you, for instance, I'm gonna clear these, and just for sakes, let's look at D neighborhoods. These are the very challenging neighborhoods. In fact, where your safety might be at risk, where your neighbors or other people think that your car is theirs, right? So you've got to be careful in these neighborhoods. So I want to see these areas where cash flow makes sense. So in this case, the problem is, let me show you. This is what I was telling you earlier. So just take the first one, Inglewood, okay? So you can buy detached single family homes for as low as close to 15,000-20,000, okay? And the rents might be about 1,000 for a three bedroom, Well, guess what? Livability score is 55. So these neighborhoods, you're going to find high crime, high vacancy. If you happen to find tenants, they might not be collectible. Okay, so you have to be very careful. If you choose to go into C and D neighborhoods, super careful, okay? Especially right now because they might be unemployed, right? So these are the markets that have suffered the most. So don't just go by, well, I can get a great deal and still collect about $1,000, $1,200 in rent, so my cash flow is gonna be great. Well, but if you have 2, 3, 4 months of vacancy, or if you find somebody that doesn't pay rent and you need to evict them, I mean, that's just not peace of mind, right? So that is why we do not look for rentals in DC areas right now, okay, for the pandemic. It's just extremely risky. So please focus on A minus and B plus. Now, why do I say A minus? Because A plus neighborhoods, they're gonna be extremely expensive, right? It's just not gonna make sense. Even though you may collect, let's say, 3,000 in rent, guess what? You're gonna need to pay like $500,000. So again, the numbers are not gonna make sense. So you need to look at affordability, high rents, livability score greater than 70, and that's what makes a great rental market. So what we did is, I asked the team, Chicago Deal team, I need a spreadsheet that I can just look. Give me the top rental markets in the suburbs. Give me the top rental markets in the city. And they came up with this list, okay? So again, at the very top, so this is in the suburbs, this is in Chicago, and this is just a snippet of it, okay? Because we have analyzed over 350 areas. So the list goes on and on and on, but I just wanted to give you a snippet of what it looks like. So we're gonna make this available to you. So at the very top, we have Berkeley, okay? No surprises there. And we highlighted the columns that you need to pay attention to. Why Berkeley? You can find the 3-bedroom, 1-bath, or 2-bath under 160,000 and rents are through the roof, over 2,100 or so. The second best is Hillside. You can still find properties for about 160,000 and rents are very close to 2,000. And the list goes on. Bridgeview, Old Ship, Chicago Ridge, Worth, Flossmoor, Franklin Park, Streamwood. Now, something to keep in mind, even once you have this information, you also need to pay attention to deal breakers. What are those deal breakers? Because everything looks great here on paper, right? You may find a great deal, rents are high. Deal breakers are taxes, okay? So there are some areas that are like in the top rental list that have very high taxes. So even if you find a great deal for a great price and rents are high, taxes are going to kill your cash flow, okay? So that's something that you really need to check. At the area level that where taxes are high, like Flossmoor, it's an example of a suburb that taxes are very high. And also in the city, there are some pockets where taxes are extremely high. In fact, Cook County has increased their taxes by over 10-20%. So it's just insane. So please make sure that you also double check taxes, because taxes will have a direct impact in your bottom line for cash flow. Okay, super, super important. And then we have a list for Chicago, right? So here we have some of the top markets as well. So we like to focus right now on the suburbs. We're gonna make these, and also we have a bigger list. I just wanted to show you the example for you to focus on. Sweet spot to buy, median rental income over 1600, and also livability score. We should highlight these, okay? I'm gonna highlight it so that you can see it. So we're gonna be looking at livability score due to the pandemic for areas above 70%. So I would, for instance, not go into Chicago Ridge. Okay, it's got a livability score of 67. Okay, so it's a C neighborhood. Okay, that is why. Okay, the lower the livability score, the lower the area type rating. Okay, so right now, these are the areas where you have the most unemployment. B plus, A minus, they are white collar people who get to work remotely from home. They have not lost their jobs. So that is why right now we are not focusing on C markets. We're staying away from them. Another one is like this one. C, again, it's a C justice. Plus justice is way too far out west. Okay, so another one right here, Plano. Plano, it's a great upcoming area, but it's way too far for us. So that's something that is super important now that I'm talking about distance. Once you narrow down top rental markets, you need to make sure that they are within a 10-mile radius from where you live or where you work. So let me give an example. You may live in, let's say, by O'Hare, Des Plaines, but you may work in Streamwood, right? So you have a belt. So within that belt, you need to draw a 10-mile radius. So either in your commute to work or back home, you should be able to have a radius of about 10 miles in between these two areas, two points. Why? Because the minute you start going farther than 10, 15 miles away from where you live or where you work, guess what? It becomes unmanageable for your rehab, for your maintenance. And not only that, but let's assume that you find some great maintenance or handyman. They're not gonna wanna go like super far, okay? So just be aware of that. The rule of thumb is a 10-mile radius from where you live, start focusing, okay? So, but we wanna make sure that you are off to a very fast start by giving you the top rental markets. So you don't need to think, create, work, nothing. All you need to do is this a B area, right? Or is this an A area? Like this one, right? Like Flossmoor, it's a great area, A area. But remember, cost of living, and in fact, it has a D plus. So that means taxes in Flossmoor are very high. And also, once you make sure taxes are reasonable in the neighborhood, is within your 10 mile radius. Super important, friends, okay, to understand. I want to go back and see if you have any questions. Okay, let me go back to the chat box. Are there any questions? Any questions so far? Can everyone hear me? Any questions? Okay, Debbie. Okay, thank you, Debbie. I hope you were listening to everything that I was saying earlier.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah, of course.
Yes, Hugo, I'm in the Midway Airport area, and it's next to Garfield Ridge neighborhood. What's the livability score for clearing?
Okay, so you are in, where are you, Clearing?
Clearing is C-L-E-A-R-I-N-G.
Hello, welcome back. Thank you for joining us. Okay, let me search for it. Okay, right here. So it's a C neighborhood, livability score is 60, 62. So right now, for instance, we wouldn't go there. So let me tell you. The sweet spot to buy, it's 210, so it's kind of high, and the rents are below. They're close to 1600 for a three-bedroom, but the livability score is just okay. So if you decide to go into this neighborhood, just be cautious, right? Because right now, these neighborhoods were hit the hardest.
Yeah.
So just be aware of it. Well, yeah, great question. So this is in the city.
I got a question.
Yes.
So just say, if you got a purchase price of $150,000, and you got a rental market of $1,600, what would be your rehab cost if you was to purchase something $150,000? Where would you keep your budget at?
Okay, great question. So the question is, the rent is good, $1,600. The purchase price is $150,000. That's awesome. But what would your rehab cost should be? Your rehab cost for still the numbers to make sense should be less than $40,000. Okay. If you go over $40,000, guess what? Your numbers on the back end may not work. Okay. And the reason why, I mean, if you buy it for $150,000, that property better appraise for at least $250,000, $100,000 more. And the scope of, I mean, the rehab should be less than $40,000, and the rent should be no less than $1,600.
Okay.
So keep that in mind. Less than $40,000. That's considered light to medium rehab. What we mean by that is that you're going to be doing flooring, updating the kitchens, updating the bathrooms, light fixtures, paint. That's it. You're not going to be putting a new roof, new windows, new electric, new plumbing, new mechanicals, none of that. Every time you touch or redo a system, it's about $7,000 to $12,000. Okay, so you just want to do light to medium rehab. You don't want to like get into a gut rehab project.
Okay, and on the same question, just say, I guess your average sweet spot for taxes would be what, $5,000?
Exactly, $5,000 to $6,000. But okay. There are some areas like Des Plaines, Skokie, for instance, taxes are through the roof, like $8,000, $9,000. So that's going to tap into your cash flow, the bottom line.
Okay. Appreciate it.
Thank you. Are there any other questions on the line? Great questions. Okay, how do you find good contractors? That's a great question. So we happen to be working with the same people for the last 2.5 years. So they're very reliable. And we share all our resources right here on the preferred partners. Over 90 contractors, you know, plumbers, you name it, electricians, everything. So we share our contractors with you, okay? Okay, livability. So you want to understand more about livability. So livability, it's pretty much a summary of many factors. I'm going to show you what the livability score measures. Livability is a summary for amenities, cost of living, crime, education, employment, housing, and weather. Okay, so we are looking at livability right now with the pandemic of areas of 70 and up. 70 and below, you may not get collectible tenants, okay? Be very cautious. Like livability score of less than 50, you won't even get a contractor to go there to make repairs. You may have vacancies of 3 months at least. You may get tenants, but they may not be collectible. You may end up doing eviction. So it's super extremely risky to go into right now the and C minus areas, okay, the challenging areas. You've got to go into the better neighborhoods at this time, right? Maybe in 2-3 years you can change that approach, but right now you are asking for trouble if you were to go into areas with livability score less than 70. It is that simple. Okay, so for instance, right now landlords who own properties in these C neighborhoods have been hit the hardest because those people have been the ones that lost their jobs, so they can't afford to pay rents and they cannot be evicted either, right? So that is why they have felt the pandemic the hardest. You've got to stick to B plus, A minus neighborhoods. They're still working, could be remotely, they might have gone back to work. You're going to have your rent on time, okay? Super important. Livability score over 70%. Are there any other questions? Would I be able to apply these techniques in mobile home investments? Absolutely. It's the same concept. Okay. It's absolutely the same concept because with mobile home, it's just a rental market as well. So you've got to be able to apply the same techniques. Okay. Super important. Same techniques. I guess you don't recommend Dalton, Calumet City. Absolutely. You are correct. So I'm going to show you why. So let's just look at Dalton. So the first thing that I do is see area livability score 61, okay? I know Dalton is struggling a lot. So right now, because of that, we wouldn't go into Dalton. Now let's look at the numbers. Sweet spot to buy, it's pretty reasonable. You can buy something for 40, 50, 60,000. Rents out about 1,000. But let me show you something. Let's look at vacancy in Dalton, okay? So right off the bat, just by looking at the livability, we would not buy rentals in Dalton right now. Okay, crime is above average. I wanna see income. Household median income is less than the average, is 46,000. Population growth is negative by 10%. And then let's look at vacancy. So vacancy is 14% right here. Vacant housing units, 14%. You don't want to buy a rental in a neighborhood where the vacancy rate is over 10%. In Dalton, it's 14%. Absolutely, right now, I would not go into Dalton. Okay, it is that simple. Things may change in a year, 2 years, but right now, no, you're asking for troubles. You need to have peace in mind, right? You need to keep it simple, okay? So don't get super excited because you're gonna buy something cheap thinking you're gonna collect $1,000. But right now, a lot of people in Dalton have lost their jobs. So you may have a vacancy of 20%, 2-3 months, and then all your cash flow is gonna go negative. So please be cautious about it. And another area that you mentioned was Calumet City. I believe it's along the same lines. So let me just quickly check Calumet City. Right here, Calumet City. So Calumet City, right here, it's a C, livability score 62. It's the same story. So I could go into the details and show you the vacancy. Population growth, so it's high vacancy, negative population growth, you're asking for trouble, right? And then above average, when it comes to crime, it's not the best area to go in right now. Maybe it was before the COVID, before March. Yeah, I could have gone there, but not right now, okay? It's just too risky. Now, another question is, Dalton municipality is hostile and holds thousands in escrow. Absolutely. I've heard not too good things about Dalton. They hold landlord responsible for crimes committed by tenants. Absolutely. Betsy, thank you very much for your comments. I've heard also not the best things about Dalton. So yeah, I wouldn't go into Dalton. What is the average rent amount in Oswego? Okay, so Oswego, it's kind of far. So I'll just look it up, Oswego. Search Oswego for a three bedroom, it would be 1663. Purchase price, it's a B area, 73. Sweet spot to buy, it's 273. So Oswego, thumbs up for that. Hopefully you can buy a property under 175,000 in Oswego, Kendall County. So it is good. So something that you can look into, Oswego. Okay. Now what's another question is, Hugo, your program is very comprehensive. Thank you. I'm a landlord. Thank you, Betsy. Thank you. Yeah, no, I mean, when you have a question, you've got to be able to find these answers in seconds. If you spend more than 5 minutes, 10, 15, half an hour, 45 minutes, something is really wrong. You should be able to find the answers in seconds, like Oswego, right? Or like Dalton. What's up with Dalton? You should be able to find that in less than 30 seconds. That's how simple real estate should be, especially when you have access to the right information at the right time. And that's what life is all about, access to the right information. I mean, if you think about it, like the best companies, Amazon, Google, Facebook, it's all about information, having access to the information at the right time. Another question is, how is Aurora, Batavia, Bolingbrook areas for rental? Aurora, great. Batavia, I'm not familiar. We could look it up. Bolingbrook is great. Bolingbrook, I know population growth is super high, over 30%. I know Amazon is going there. So it's great. Batavia, now, does somebody have a question on the line?
Yes, Hugo.
Yes.
I was away for a few minutes. I had something to do. But utility paid. What's your opinion on making sure that all utilities are paid by the tenants?
Okay, so gas and electric.
Yes, and electric.
Gas, electric, and water. Okay, so, I mean, if they don't pay for gas and electric, eventually it's going to affect their FICO score. But we screen tenants thoroughly. If they have a FICO score of over 650, we know they're going to be responsible enough to pay for their own utilities. Sometimes they may fall behind in the water bill. We might help with this, but then we're going to request at least 2 months of security deposit. Okay.
So you also have them pay the water bill. Their usage of water.
Absolutely. They all pay for the water bill for single family homes. We also own multi-units, like 3-4 flats. In that case, we pay for the water. Okay. So they don't pay for water. And we also pay for scavenger or garbage. But single family homes, they pay for everything. Snow removal, garbage, water. Well, the garbage is including the taxes, gas, electric. So they pay for everything.
Okay.
Another question, what are the number ranges for different neighborhoods? A, B, C, D, livability scores. Okay. So 80 and up, it's A area. And then 70, between 70 and 80 is B. Below 70, between 70 and 60 is C. And below 60 is D, okay? So therefore, right now, livability score should be 70 and up, right now, okay? Don't go into 70 and below for investing. That's way too risky right now. Livability score, great question, by the way, should be 70 and up right now for you to invest. Another question is, do you, let me see, where do you recommend getting a large wall map of 10? Oh, great question, Debbie. I mentioned earlier that you need to draw a 10-mile radius, right, from where you live. There's a really cool website from Google. I think it's called, let me see, Maps. I'll get it for you. Google Maps radius right here. Google Map radius right here. I'm going to send you the link. It's really cool. Great question. So let me show you how it works. I'm going to put this link on the chat so everyone can do this from your computer or phone. So the way it works, you put in the address, let's say 4047 North Cumberland, and then I want a 10-mile radius, new circle. Boom. Oh, I needed to put Chicago, Illinois. Chicago and so forth. Okay, new circle. Okay, boom. So what happened there is that I drew a 10-mile radius from Hardwick Heights. Okay, that's 4047. Cumberland. Okay, so from here, boom, it's going to do a 10-mile radius from Chicago. Okay, so super important. Make sure that you do that when it comes to finding your area. So don't go beyond 15 miles, okay, for sure. Never beyond 15 miles because you are going to neglect your property, your project, your tenants. I mean, forget it. It's just not doable. Over 15-mile radius, no way. Another question, do tenants pay for water in Chicago rentals? Yes, they all pay. except if it's a multi-unit. If it's 2 to 4, they don't pay for water. Another question is, any cost-saving tips for multi-unit family, like reducing water, insurance, utilities? So for multi-units, we have 3 multi-units. You pay for water, common electric, they pay for gas and electric. There's not much savings. We also pay for the exterior maintenance and also for the dumpster. So there's not much savings on multi-unit, but obviously it all comes down to how much you pay for the unit. And also the incentive for multi-units is cash flow, right? You have more units, therefore you're paying less per unit. Your cash flow should be greater. Another question, no further questions. Okay, great. So I hope you have a full understanding now. I'm gonna make a quick summary of everything we did. So first of all, what makes a great rental market? Affordability, no more than 175,000. High rents, over 1,600. Livability score right now, because of the pandemic, should be over 70, okay? Anything below 70, you may have high vacancies, not collectible tenants. Be extremely cautious. Right now, your strategy should be on 70 and up for livability score. That also combined with the radius from where you live and work. So do a belt. You work, you live, that's a belt. Do a 10-mile radius around that. The website I send you right now will help you do that. Make sure that you analyze those areas for you to be able to find the top rental markets in Chicago. Dealable, we're also going to make this spreadsheet available to you. And then a tip of advice, please pay attention to the deal breaker, taxes, okay? Because even if you find a great deal for a great price with high rents, taxes can kill your cash flow. So please be very cautious of deal breaker, what's called taxes. And also the village, right? Some villages are super hard to work with, but that's second. It's not a deal breaker. Just taxes will have a direct impact into your bottom line. Okay, so that's just a quick summary, friends. I want to make sure that you have access to what I showed you today. So get Chicago Deal Vault for free for the next 30 days. Okay. So all you need to do is for the package, select special Chicago Deal Vault. And then here for the promo code, we created rental. Okay, so the promo code if you're a member, we're gonna email you the spreadsheet. So please send an email to support@chicagodealvault.com and ask for top rental markets. Okay, we were able to pull the spreadsheet from Deal Vault, okay? But we can send you the spreadsheet. So I want to make sure that you don't have to think, create, work, nothing. I want to make sure that you focus on what's going to make you money, finding great deals and get them on the contract, okay? So please ask for that. You have that. Perfect, Debbie. Awesome. So now make sure that you have access. Remember, we're running our bootcamp, our super important end of the month. Make sure that you RSVP. We're gonna try to do a live event if everything continues the way it is. Super important. It's gonna be a great opportunity for you to learn everything from wholesaling, flipping, and rentals. I'm gonna give it all to you. And most importantly, our secret sauce, our strategy to build a $1 million rental empire. Okay, so make sure that you RSVP for that. And then I look forward to seeing you on our next event on Thursday. Okay, on Thursday, we're going to be talking about flips, okay, flipping markets. So it's a whole new game ball, okay, ball game. So Thursday, make sure that you join. We're going to be talking about flips. So thank you, everyone, for joining. Yeah, absolutely. Taxes. That's a great point, Mark. Great question about taxes. I believe taxes are not included in this spreadsheet, but I'm going to send a message to the team to make sure they include that into the spreadsheet, okay? So that you're aware of neighborhoods that have super high taxes, okay? So thank you everyone again for joining, and I look forward to seeing you this Thursday. We're going to be talking about the top flipping markets and how to find them and what makes a great flipping market. So thank you everyone again for joining. Have a wonderful evening, and I look forward to seeing you on Thursday. Please get Dealbook for free. I send you the instructions, the form, and RSVP for our bootcamp end of the month. Thank you everyone. See you Thursday. Have a wonderful evening. I'm going to remain on the line for the next couple of minutes to answer any questions that you may have.
Thank you, Valerie.
What was the question?
What website? What to go on to get the Chicago Deal Vault? What you say? Go on Chicago Deal.
Yes, you can get it for free. Everything that I showed today, I'm gonna send you this in the chat, the link. So fill this out, and then in the package right here, make sure that you select special. So I'm going to put it on the chat. So for the package, select special Chicago Deal Vault. And then for the promo code should be rental. And then you're going to get it for free for the next 30 days. And you can, everything that I show you today, you're going to be able to see and more. I just show you like 3% of Chicago Deal Vault. I mean, it's extremely rich. And then we're going to be able to train you one-on-one, unlimited, via Zoom, okay? Because in Deal Vault, you're going to be able to access the MLS as if you were a broker. You're going to be able to have access to all the off-market properties like probates, pre-foreclosures, auctions, shadow inventory or bank-owned properties, cash buyers, private lenders, you name it, the whole nine yards. So please make sure that you sign up. It's free, okay, for the next 30 days.